with that, thank you for coming out tonight.
So I come to you today as a woman of faith, as a bishop, and a pastor of a church. But more than that, I come to you today as a mother and a grandmother and a woman who lives in white skin. And just as a few others did so beautifully, I am especially calling on all of us who look like me. You see, I may come from a Christian perspective, but what Jesus taught is something that I think is at the heart of every religion. He taught the greatest commandment. And do you know that that greatest commandment comes from the book of Deuteronomy? And it is the beginning of a Jewish prayer called the Shema. We are combined in our traditions and in all faith traditions that are grounded in good. We are called to action. At Mary Magdalene Church, there are various things that we're doing, but one of the things that I've done is put together quite a resource list for our community that I share freely. It's a part of our bulletin. You can find it on Facebook. And in that, it has exactly that. It has those opportunities to learn more. Not only did Jesus say, love our God with all our heart, our soul, and mind, and love our neighbors, ourselves, but then he upped the ante at the end. He said, love one another as I have loved you. So if our God doesn't call us to see one another in this beautiful array of colors as all being a part of the people of God, all created in that same image and likeness with the beauty of our diversity. You know, I heard a little six-year-old girl named Gianna, who is George Floyd's daughter, who has not even yet been told how her father died. And she looked around at all the crowds and she said, Daddy changed the world. You know what? There is a lot of momentum behind us right now, and in many ways, we are at an unprecedented moment in time. But you know what? If we look at history, we've been at this precipice many, many times before. We can look back at times in history where there was movement that said, yes, our black, our brown, our brothers and sisters of color, people of every race and color and hue, all created in the image of God. And until we all see one another in that way, we're not going to go anywhere. Now, we've been at this position before, but you know, I'm going to say that those of us who are white, you know, there comes a time where we start to get a little weary. And then we see a law change, right? Well, Kevin spoke at our community on this past Sunday. We invited him to preach. And one of the things that he said, you know, laws can be made that say that you cannot kill me, but there's no law that says that you must love me. That law comes from our God, and people of any faith who are here can draw from our faith to call for change. You see, we cannot stop when momentum begins to die down, when the demonstrations end, when our emotions quell and the energy becomes diverted, because you know what, it will. Lives go on and on. And for those of us who are white, the temptation is to go home to the comfort of our white skin and sleep in our beds at night. And you know what? If we do that, we still have our black and brown and people of color and gay and lesbian and transgendered and bisexual and queer and questioning who cannot sleep in their bed at night in the same way we can. And until we can all go to bed at night and lay our heads on our pillows and know that we are all valued for who we are, that none of us needs to fear when we walk out our door. That we can live in our homes, that we can be in our schools, that we can be in our churches and on our streets, no matter the color of our skin, no matter what we're wearing, no matter what the circumstances of our life are, in safety. And for those of us who are white, we've grown up in a world where people are treated differently dependent upon the color of their skin. And you know what? It's just the world that we've been grown up, that we've all grown up in. And I want to challenge those of us who are white. So often when we get in these circles and we begin to face the white privilege that we've had, and we begin to look and we begin to feel guilty, and we begin to feel shameful, and we begin to share that, we've got our work to do. And just as one of our speakers earlier said, I don't remember who said it, we cannot look to our black and brown and people of color to do our work for us. Yes, we need to look at those issues, but as soon as we start to move into that place, we derail the meaningful parts of conversation. And so, and I know at our church, we're doing more than just talking about it every once in a while. We're gathering together. We're gathering with, many of us are with the Rochester Anti-Racism Action Coalition meetings. We're having anti-racism workshops in our community. And we're asking all of us to identify what is the areas in our life and in our world where we can make a difference. Because that's what we have to do. And no matter where your church, your temple, your synagogue, your mosque, or wherever you find your faith, call upon your leaders to stand up and to do something, because it is only when we dig in for the long haul, when we realize that everyone is loved for who they are and valued, when no one's welfare is in question because of the color of their skin, their gender identity, their sexual orientation, that we can really reflect the world that God intended for all of us to inhabit. And that takes us working together for the long haul. We have to take that little Giannis challenge, Daddy changed the world, and not let this be a moment in time, but a watershed. Something that forever changes life from this point on. Words. It is our challenge.
Okay, so one quick announcement. So this is the portion where it's open mic. Whoever wants to come up.